So with off-label dosing, study by Barbara looked at 224 patients with atrial fibrillation. And on the table here, this is the percentage of patients that actually met criteria for dose reduction.
Ruben, I can hear recording. Yes. If you start sharing again, because we could hear the voice recording. Carlos, we may start. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Good morning. Good evening. Good afternoon. Good evening. Depends where you are. Here we are with another FIP event, digital event. This day is a pharmacy-based anticoagulation management. Pharmacy cares supporting patients with not communicable disease. I am Carlos Lacaba. I am FIP Vice President, and I will be the moderator of this webinar. Today we have with us Dr. Sahimi Mohammed, Dr. Nida Nakhmi, and Dr. Rose Ann. Some announcements for you to have into account. This webinar is being recorded and live streamed via YouTube. The recording will be available on our website, events.fip.org. You may ask questions using the question box provided. Question and answer box. You are welcome to provide feedback to webinars@fip.org. Become a member of FIP at fip.org/membership-registration. Thank you. The learning objectives of this session will be identify the different issues impacting anticoagulation management, recognize the crucial role of pharmacists in enhancing the management of anticoagulation, explain the role technology can play in supporting anticoagulation management, describe the barriers and opportunities that pharmacists in leading anticoagulation managed services. The program will be this introduction, then identify issues and challenges affecting anticoagulation management by enrolls, establishing the role pharmacists in enhancing anticoagulant management by Mohammed Sahimi. Take to the rescue, vital lessons from providing online anticoagulation management service in the era of the pandemic by Nida Nashmi. Then a discussion and a wrap up our conclusion by me. Well, first, we are going to have Dr. Rose Ann. Dr. Rose is an inpatient pharmacist manager of patient care service focusing on internal medicine and cardiology. She's the coordinator of anticoagulation stewardship program at the University of Wisconsin Hospital and Health Systems, Madison, Wisconsin, United States of America. We have the presentation of Dr. Rose pre-recorded.
Hello, I'm Anne Rose, and I'd like to thank the International Pharmaceutical Federation for inviting me to speak on the topic of identifying issues and challenges affecting today's anticoagulation management. So when I was thinking about this topic, I really looked at what were some of the issues and challenges that I face on a daily basis in my practice. So four of the things that came top of mind were first applying, you know, what we know about the literature and some of our newer anticoagulants to our real world patient population, thinking specifically about, you know, now that we have so many different therapeutic options, how do we select the best one for our patient? And then how do we tackle those patients that are on off-label indications or who may have been put on more off-label dosing? Second, you know, with the introduction of the direct oral anticoagulants, how are we incorporating these patients into our practice, especially if we are already involved in a busy, you know, traditional warfarin management clinic? Third being education. How do we get that education out to our clinicians and patients whenever there are, you know, new drugs available or new indications? And then finally, thinking about our electronic health record and how do we utilize that electronic health record to help combat some of these challenges. So since 2010, we now have had, you know, a variety of different DOACs that are available to us, and all with really varying indications. So when we're thinking about, you know, patients and what to select for anticoagulation treatment, you know, a lot of things come to mind, things like renal function, the weight of the patient, why are we using it? Are they on other medications that can potentially interact with the drug I'm trying to select, or are they on other antiplatelet therapies already? Compliance and cost, of course, all come into play as well. Now, we know that the trials, especially the ones that were helpful with getting approval for indications, were very targeted to very specific patient populations. And, you know, oftentimes when we're practicing, not all of our patients fit in exactly to that patient population that were studied. So, you know, what happens when our patients don't match that? Of course, selection should be based on individual patient factors, but keeping in mind all of those factors, you know, anticoagulation specialists or specialized programs may be best suited for helping patients decide on these treatment options. Of course, we all know about the DOAC gray zones, you know, and these are just a few of the indications that I have seen patients using DOACs for, and, you know, of course, they're not necessarily approved or indicated for these specific disease states, but there is some literature out there. But how do we, again, look at that literature and apply it to the patients that we're caring for? Same thing with extremes of body weight. You know, we know that optimal dosing strategies have not been established yet, especially for our patients that are greater than 120 kilos or less than 50 kilos. And of course, pregnancy and breastfeeding, not a lot of data there as well. So, you know, for these patients, are we necessarily stuck with warfarin? You know, maybe not. But again, having these anticoag specialists or specialized clinics really help individualize the care for these special populations. And hopefully, of course, we'll continue to get more data for use in these disease states. So with off-label dosing, this has been studied. We do have some studies listed here that have looked at prescribing practices and more specifically how off-label dosing impacts our patients. The first study by Barra looked at 224 patients with atrial fibrillation. And on the table here, this is a percentage of patients that actually met criteria for dose reduction. So this study looked only at patients with reduced dosing. And as you can see there, only a small percentage of patients that were receiving dose reductions actually met the right criteria. So large percentage of population, especially in the apixaban and dabigatran groups, that were potentially on an inappropriate dose. Whitworth also looked at this. They looked at it more collectively, though, so it was not individualized with each of these DOACs, but on a collective basis, again, found that only 40% were receiving the dosing based on label recommendations. They did find that apixaban tended to be the DOAC that had the most incorrect dosing. And then finally, the Trujillo-Santos study did take it one step forward and looked at outcomes. And so with this population, looking at VTE, again, they found sort of a similar trend with only, you know, about half of the population or so, especially with apixaban and dabigatran, being on the recommended dose, but found that those patients that were on DOACs at the non-recommended dose had a higher rate of VTE recurrence with similar bleeding rates. So being on that lower or reduced dose didn't decrease the rate for bleeding. So we know that there are risks with off-label dosing, especially regarding outcomes, major bleeding, also stroke, all-cause mortality. We know that there are higher rates of bad outcomes, again, stroke and all-cause mortality when patients don't adhere to their medications. And I feel like anticoag clinics were pretty quick to jump on incorporating the DOAC into management, into their clinics. And we do have some data from DOAC monitoring programs that do suggest that patients have higher adherence rates when they are being followed more closely. So this is an example of our DOAC monitoring program where I work at the University of Wisconsin. And so we do have periodic touch points with patients, depending on, you know, where they are in therapy, whether it's the first year versus anything after that first year, and then finally looking at like their age and renal function as well. But we looked to see when we implemented this program, how long it was going to take us to incorporate the patients into our clinic. And so for any new patient, or if we're coordinating like a transition from warfarin to a DOAC or other care, we do keep around 45 minutes for those visits. And then for any follow-up, we target about 15 minutes for follow-up. So when we're looking at the number of DOAC patients we have in our system, it being 3,000, wow, we were really surprised at how much extra work this was going to be to incorporate all of these patients into our clinic setting. So, you know, excess of 2,000 hours of work for any new patient coming in, and then annually about 750 hours per work. This on top of an already busy warfarin management clinic really caused us to pause and say, you know, do we have the resources for this? What other options do we have? So depending on where you work and the health system that you're in, if you utilize clinical technicians, this is an area that you can focus on potentially helping to solve this challenge of, you know, how do we incorporate these DOAC patients? Can we expand the role of the clinical technician? I have on the slide here a table that looks at different administrative and clinical activities that the technicians can be involved in. I know from our standpoint and just our experience, it has increased overall job satisfaction, keeps our staff working at the top of their license. Our pharmacists really then are dedicated to doing more of the complex clinical activity, and then overall increases operational efficiencies as well. This has been studied. There, you know, was one study looking at the work activities in an anticoag clinic and found that anywhere between 20 to 40% of activities could be handed off to trained technical staff. And then there are also studies available with clinical technicians helping to manage patients that are in their targeted INR range. So someone that, you know, patient that's stable, they've been on the same INR dose for some time, you know, having the technician communicate that INR and no change in dosing plan, again, can save on some resources and really keep your pharmacist working on more of those complex patients. Another idea is to approach the DOACs in more of a patient population health-based management. And this study comes out of the Veterans Affairs Health Systems from the United States, but they looked at how do they incorporate a patient management tool. So essentially their patients were broken down into different categories of identifying patients with maybe inappropriate indications for use, inappropriate dosing, drug interactions, non-adherence, patients that were overdue for labs. And they utilized this programming to flag these patients with clinical concern. So they didn't have to look at every DOAC patient, really just the patients that had these flags. And they found that the flags really helped identify more interventions. So they had 52 more interventions per 100 patients than their standard follow-up, which was kind of similar to what I showed you with, you know, touch points at certain time points. It also saved them time. Standard of care for them took around 20 minutes, but utilizing the patient management tool was only 14 minutes per intervention. So both effective and efficient in using this more population health-based approach. So switching gears a little bit with challenges for clinical and patient education. You know, we know that since the approval of the DOACs, we have seen that prescribing has increased. But if you look overall, and this was a European study, really showed a slow uptick in DOAC prescribing. And so we know that local implementation often lags behind our national or societal recommendation. Of course, it depends also on things like where you are regionally, overall comfort with your prescribers with these new agents or data, and then of course cost to the patient. But it is a challenge to get that education out, and we know this because when we look at our atrial fibrillation patients worldwide, about 66% of patients are undertreated. In the United States, that's about 50%. So how do we get the information out to our clinicians? And why are they, you know, prescribing or not prescribing certain things? When you look at reasons for not anticoagulating, concern for bleeding comes up as the most common reason from prescribers. Of course, now that all the DOACs and obviously warfarin or the vitamin K antagonists have reversal agents, this is a little bit less of a concern, but, you know, depending on where you are regionally and having that access can also be an issue for why patients aren't anticoagulated. Depending on your health system, clinician education can be a challenge. So, you know, looking at what is the best method to get that education out to them. And then of course with patients, you know, we have a lot of methods, whether it's teach back, face-to-face, verbal, visual. I think the thing here to really remember is that there is a lot of information and that information is everywhere. When I did just a quick search, these are like, again, all of the apps that are available to patients to download. Of course, you can Google anything. And with WebMD, you know, just type in your symptoms, what do I have? It is really overwhelming, I think, at some times for patients and just all of the places they can find information. And then from a healthcare provider, you know, concerning and making sure that the information patients are seeing is accurate and that we can trust it. But not all apps are bad, and I do want to point that out here. There was an app, mobile AFib app, that was studied, and they looked specifically at how it impacted patients. And the cool thing about this one, it was interactive with the patient. They did plug in, you know, their patient-specific information, but they found that overall they did see improved knowledge, quality of life, drug adherence, which is listed here on the slide, and overall satisfaction with anticoagulation through using this app. So something to think about as we talk with our patients and really find out where they're getting their information from, that some of these applications can be helpful for them. Looking at the electronic health record, again, what clinical decision support is available to you? So what can you program your health record to help you with? Some of the things that come to mind immediately, like drug interaction alerts, Standardization gets called out here. So can you have templated orders or care pathways so that if a patient's diagnosed with AFib, they have the same approach from a diagnosis standpoint and drug selection standpoint. And then of course, different shared decision tools or reporting dashboards like we talked about with that DOAC patient management tool. Clinical decision support tools have been studied. There are a wide variety of them out there. The most important thing to note here is they're often most successful when they are incorporated into the electronic health record. Now, while the electronic health record has made a lot of improvements in healthcare, there is an unintended consequence, of course, with alert fatigue. And this, again, has been well documented. So keep in mind, if you are going to be using things like different alerts, try to eliminate irrelevant ones. Look at, you know, tailoring them to be either based on severity or patient-specific reasons for significant alerts. And then be selective. Ask yourself, is this alert really going to solve my problem? Then finally, tracking your progress. So as we continue to combat some of these challenges and utilize different programs to help us, can your electronic health record be used to track your success? What's easily retrievable for you? And I included some metrics here for you to consider looking at. So in summary, challenges and issues will continue to exist. It's not gonna go away, especially as more therapies become available to us. They're being used for more indications and even maybe monitoring becoming available. So continue to utilize the resources that you have, whether it's within your EHR or utilization of other like technicians in clinic. Continue to promote those educational programs. And then of course, promoting special anticoag clinics or stewardship programs. This group is really what's best suited to help navigate some of these issues and challenges for our patients. Thank you so much for attending this program, and I hope you enjoy the rest of it. Thank you.
Now we will have the presentation of Dr. Sahimi Mohammed. Dr. Sahimi Mohammed is from the Department of Pharmacy of the International Islamic University of Malaysia, Pahang, Malaysia. Please, Dr. Sahimi, we hear you.
Thanks, Mr. Carlos and Chairman, and thanks for organizing committee for having me in this webinar. Hello, everyone. I am Sahimi, actually a subject matter expert in anticoagulation, and also currently I am a head of clinical pharmacy from the Heart Center Sedang Hospital. So today I'll be talking about how we can establishing our role as an anticoagulation pharmacy. As we know that anticoagulation is already available in the market since 60 years ago. So the first report of clinical use of warfarin as anticoagulation was in 1950. So as we know that anticoagulant can reduce stroke in patients with atrial fibrillation or AF as much as 62% and also can prevent valve thrombosis and reduce the risk of venous thromboembolism or VTE. However, warfarin is very difficult to manage. Next slide, Ruben. Because it has a very narrow therapeutic index, which require frequent monitoring and also have variable dosing between patients due to food and drug interaction. And it's a problem when we need to stop anticoagulant for the procedure because it need a complicated pre-procedure management because of slow onset and slow offset of warfarin. Okay, we know that all anticoagulant, include the new oral anticoagulant or direct thrombin inhibitor or DOAC, have a higher risk of bleeding, especially when patient took warfarin at the higher dose and when patient is elderly and have other comorbidities such as abnormal or liver function and inpatient anemia. And this higher risk of bleeding increase significantly if this anticoagulation therapy not managed properly. So because of the complexity of managing vitamin K antagonist or warfarin, it has led to medication error, those many of the countries develop their own anticoagulation management service. Actually, this is to reduce harm-related anticoagulation therapies, such as reducing the occurrence of VTE and also bleeding complication. As we know, there is many studies to show that when we manage anticoagulation service, there is a reduced hospitalization and also can reduce health costs. So a good anticoagulation management is crucial to prevent this any harm related to this therapy. So we can see that the over 40 years, there is evolution of anticoagulant, starting with the warfarin in 1954. Now we have the direct thrombin inhibitor, or DOAC, which is a top place of warfarin in the market since 2010. Then we have so many DOACs, such as the dabigatran, rivaroxaban, apixaban, edoxaban, and probably later on, there is many of direct oral anticoagulant. With the evolving of anticoagulation, pharmacy have many roles to optimize the patient clinical outcome. So actually, the role of pharmacy in managing anticoagulation already established before the year of 2010, because we are well known about the warfarin. So many studies shows that pharmacy implementation of pharmacy product provide anticoagulation service actually can improve not only patient outcome, but also can improve patient quality and safety. So the anticoagulation clinic actually was found to have a favorable cost over benefit ratio. Because of that, I think most of the country developed their or expand their services from outpatient setting to inpatient setting. Next one. Okay, this slide just to show the highlight when pharmacists did anticoagulation service that I mentioned earlier, they can improve the clinical patient outcome, can have a significant cost saving. Actually, pharmacy manage better than usual care, and pharmacy actually can provide equal, safe, and effective warfarin management as compared to others healthcare providers. So now how we can establish our role in managing anticoagulation in the era of DOAC? Actually, there is many things we need to do as a pharmacy who manage anticoagulation, but first and foremost, actually, for us who manage this anticoagulation, we need to update our knowledge about anticoagulation itself. And I think we already well established knowledge about the warfarin, but with the evolving of anticoagulation to DOAC, pharmacy must keep current with the therapeutic advance. And then actually, we need to find what is evidence-based knowledge and skill for to optimize patient outcomes when they use DOAC. So as we know that the new class of anticoagulant or DOAC have a lot of advantage, less drug and food interaction, no need for monitoring, but there is a lack of reversal agent can pose challenge in the face of over anticoagulation. So actually the actual impact of DOAC for pharmacy managed anticoagulation need to be established, as this class of drug is still new in the market and then the data is not well established. So for all pharmacy working in this area, enhancing management of this class of anticoagulant therapy is mandatory. So actually this slide just want to show that there is a paper, a study conducted by John and colleague to see what is the pharmacist's confidence level when providing pharmaceutical care on anticoagulation. So this is a multinational survey, which involved about 4,212 pharmacists from 21 countries. So result from these studies, they conclude that result from the study shows that they conclude that pharmacy more confident when providing anticoagulation or anticoagulation such as warfarin as compared to DOAC therapy. Next, Ruben. So as we know that we already established our knowledge about warfarin, but we still have to find the evidence base when we use this NOAC. As I mentioned earlier, there is many types of NOAC in the market. So with the increasing use of NOAC and the risk pertaining to this class of anticoagulant, this is necessary for us to educate all the pharmacy to address their knowledge gap for them to confidently support patients who receive this DOAC. The second part that the most important thing also that pharmacy need to update their knowledge about the disease which require anticoagulation therapy. And also we have to update our knowledge about the patient who have who already on lifelong anticoagulation therapy. As I mentioned earlier, anticoagulation actually can prevent stroke in AF, can prevent the occurrence of VTE, and also can prevent VAF thrombosis in VAF replacement patient. So, but however, when this patient develop a hypercoagulable state condition, as a pharmacy who manage this anticoagulant, actually we need to know what to do for this condition. And then currently we can see there is increasing number of patients who have cancer associated thrombosis. And also patients who have heart problem come to us with a left ventricle clot. What is the type of anticoagulant that we can use in this condition? And whether we can use lifelong for certain DOAC. So when patient has have leukemia also, we have to know whether we can see either DOAC can suitable use for this patient. And then currently we can see there is a COVID-19 patient, the condition which have the higher risk for VTE. So actually all the pharmacies who manage this anticoagulant need to do a proper protocol or guideline to manage this condition when they're admitted to hospital or they discharged home, whether to extend the VTE prophylaxis extend the VTE prophylaxis or give short duration for VTE prophylaxis. Okay. And then the other part is to improve our knowledge about the managing of bleeding, especially for when there is a major bleeding related to DOAC. As we know that we already have a reversal agent for warfarin, I think all the hospital who manage this anticoagulation already keep the reversal agent and then know what to do when a patient came to emergency department with over-warfarinization. But when patient come for the major bleeding due to NOAC, we have to find out what is the type of DOAC that patient use, because different DOAC have different reversal agent. As we also need to put in our mind that the reversal agent for DOAC is quite expensive, probably is not available at our setting. So we need to know what is the agent to stop the bleeding related to DOAC. And then we need to know how to manage to correct the over anticoagulation in case patient need for emergency procedure. And then also as a pharmacy who manage this anticoagulant, we need to find out the availability of some agents to stop bleeding, such as protombin concentrate complex and fresh frozen plasma, the availability of this product at our hospital level. So I think we also need to know how to calculate the bleeding risk assessment, especially for elderly people or patients who have other comorbidities such as abdomen, liver, or renal function. Next. So I think the other part that we always ignore is the monitoring part, monitoring of anticoagulation effect. So because we thought this is not our job, this is other healthcare provider need to monitoring this part. But now with the evolution of, I think we need to know at least the basic how we need to monitor the anticoagulation effect. So knowledge about the coagulation cascade, how we can help in the blood transfusion, monitoring the patient platelet function, especially when patient have thrombocytopenia, we need to stop and then when we can reinitiate back the anticoagulation for this patient. And then we also need to know the effect of anticoagulation pharmacokinetic on coagulation markers. Okay. So for us to gain all the knowledge that I mentioned earlier, actually, we need to attend a specialized training either at local or international level. So this is should be mandatory requirement made by the policymaker. So certification in the pharmacy of field and especially for anticoagulation care is the way to demonstrate our advanced knowledge and skill to manage anticoagulation. So as in US, they have the National Certification Board Anticoagulation Provider. So this the mission of the board to improve the quality of patient care through recognition and promotion of specialized knowledge and skill pertaining to antithrombotic therapy. So actually, for pharmacists who manage this anticoagulation therapy need to attend this National Certificate Board as a clinical pharmacy who already certified this anticoagulation care can empower them to function better in anticoagulation management, not only at their facility, their state, or can also function well in the worldwide as well. So last but not least, we need to re-evaluate back pharmacists who attend the specialized training to assess their clinical competency and performance to check their ability to identify, resolve, and prevent any therapist problem related to managing anticoagulation therapy. Although some we have a different training for certification of pharmacy, but varies between state and country, but validating anticoagulation pharmacy who fulfill a certification requirement is mandatory. Last but not least, I think we need also recognition from the policymaker to recognize all the pharmacy who already attend the specialized training to award them as a clinical pharmacy specialist in anticoagulation as in US, UK, and Singapore. In Malaysia, we awarded the pharmacy who already have a specialized training as a subject matter expert in anticoagulation. Although some of the country, I think they didn't recognize this pharmacy as specialized in anticoagulation, but at least at local level, they are recognized this pharmacy as pharmacy lead anticoagulation clinic and also one of the member for anticoagulation management service. So as a summary, actually the clinical competency are important to establish our role of a clinical pharmacy in enhancing the anticoagulation therapy management. So this actually this clinical competency only can be maintained through practice, continuous professional development, formalized education, and we conduct a special training. So we hope that after this, we can do more collaboration with other state and country to optimize our role as an anticoagulation pharmacy. So assessing clinical competency and performance actually remain a key aspect to evaluate the clinical abilities and skill to achieve the highest standard anticoagulation therapy management and improve patient clinical outcome. So I hope that by now we have now the way how to establish our role. With that, I end my presentation. Thank you for attending and listening.
Thank you, Dr. Sahimi. Now, finally, we have Dr. Nida Nahmi. Dr. Nahmi is a specialist in anticoagulation pharmacist and founder of online anticoagulation management service from Pakistan. Please, Dr. Nida, go ahead.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Carlos. It's a pleasure to be here. And I would also like to thank FIP for inviting me to such an interesting talk. Hello, everyone. I am Nidhan Ajmi, and I am a specialized and certified anticoagulation pharmacist from Pakistan. And today I am going to talk about the technology to the rescue and what are the vital lessons from providing online anticoagulation management services from a Pakistani perspective. Next slide, please. Okay, I begin with a quick background of healthcare system in Pakistan. Then I'll talk about the need of telemedicine. And finally, a brief introduction of online anticoagulation management services in terms of purpose, services provided, challenges faced, and the way forward. So about the healthcare systems in Pakistan, despite of increasing health problems day by day, treatment is basically not affordable for everyone in Pakistan. Our 70% of population go to the private hospital, which is an expensive choice, basically because our private hospitals charge more. And our general population avoid going to go to the government provided healthcare facilities because usually their services are not up to the mark. And also there is an absence of third party payers or what we can say health insurance from facilities from government agencies. That's a big main issue. So overall, there is a low power health infrastructure in Pakistan. So as a developing country, telemedicine in industry is basically expanding in Pakistan, but still there is a long way to go. Okay, since anticoagulation patients, the patients who are using anticoagulants require continuous monitoring and specialized counseling. But unfortunately, in here in Pakistan, these patients are treated by general physicians. And we do not have any proper tracking system for those patients who are using anticoagulants and who are on anticoagulation therapy. This makes, and also there is a serious shortage of pharmacist-led anticoagulation management services here in Pakistan. Next slide, please. So coming to the need of telemedicine, we have observed that the world is transforming into a more digital platforms. So due to this pandemic, therefore the telemedicine became a necessity for the continuum of care. As we already know that we can't left anticoagulated patients alone for a long period of time, as we do with the diabetic patients or hypertensive patients. So while telemedicine offers an opportunity for patients to obtain immediate advice from healthcare professionals or contact directly from healthcare professionals, but it also increases many challenges, especially in a developing country like Pakistan. So being a healthcare professional and certified anticoagulation pharmacist, I felt there was a huge gap in our community regarding the awareness about anticoagulation therapy, the knowledge about the conditions requiring anticoagulation therapy, and blood thinners itself is also lacking. So, as far as my knowledge is concerned, I am not aware of any online platform which is providing online anticoagulation management services. So hence the need for this setup is there's a dire need of this setup. So with the below purposes, Number one was the to spread the awareness about the condition, disease conditions that require anticoagulation therapy, and about the safe and effective use of anticoagulants itself. The purpose number two was to provide an accessible platform for patients and as well as for the healthcare professionals to ask anticoagulation-related problems directly from pharmacists, and highlight the role of pharmacists in managing the anticoagulation therapy, provide support to the primary physicians, and help decrease emergency room visits caused by the adverse effect of anticoagulants. Okay, by keeping these objectives in mind, the first step was to build awareness in community by producing educational videos about the common problems related to anticoagulation and blood thinners itself, and also providing patient education material on some basic topics like, please change the slide. Some basic topics like side effects of blood thinners and what are the do's and don'ts of blood thinners. And also on some advanced topics, next slide please. And also on some advanced topic like what to look for if you are pregnant or going through a dental procedure if you are on anticoagulation therapy. All these efforts are to highlight the role of pharmacists in anticoagulation therapy management. Next slide, please. Okay. Since the work is in its initial stage, the data has not been collected yet, but I'm in a process of doing so in future. So my observation was soon after its establishment, online anticoagulation management get attention by pharmacy community, and also by and also got immediate response both by patients and pharmacy community, and which was reflected by its views and likes on social media. I started to get queries both from my pharmacy colleagues, and which are usually about the management of anticoagulation therapy during COVID-19. And also I started to take queries from patients, which are usually about taking dose adjustments and taking care of their anticoagulation therapy during COVID-19, and also about some myths related to aspirin and COVID-19. So as far as my observation is concerned, pharmacists, if get a chance, pharmacists can play an important role in management of anticoagulation therapy. Next, please. The challenges of online anticoagulation management services were the lack of awareness in general public. Unfortunately, Pakistan's literacy rate is only 59%, and 1/3 of our population lives below the poverty line. All these things are making the access difficult for general public. So the 60% of our population deprived of access to the internet because they live in the rural areas of Pakistan. So, and the biggest challenge for me is the recognition as a pharmacist to be a part of anticoagulation management team, both by public and other healthcare stakeholders. So what are the lessons and what I have learned through this my short journey, that although literacy rate and accessibility to healthcare facilities are insufficient in Pakistan, the necessity of telemedicine is growing. And such platforms are with multidisciplinary team in which a pharmacist should be a must is highly needed in Pakistan, especially in Pakistan. And also physician can play an important role to divert patient to the pharmacist, which can, of course, increase the compliance of patient, decrease the side effects of the anticoagulants, and overall decrease their own burden. Thank you so much. This was my short presentation. And thank you for attending. And this is where you can find me. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Nakmi. Well, we now can receive questions, even to Dr. Rose. Despite she is not here with us, we can send the questions you have to her. Up to the moment, we have two questions to Dr. Sahimi regarding that if you are in a position to provide training to international pharmacists wanting to get certified in anticoagulation.
Thanks for the question. Actually, yes, of course. We provide training to our local pharmacists, but if we are to provide international pharmacists in anticoagulation management, actually we are looking forward positively because when we provide training for the local pharmacists, we do collaboration with others, cardiologists, physicians, to give some lectures or talks, and also about the management. Because when we do our anticoagulation clinic at our hospital level, we actually collaborate with them. So because in Malaysia, we cannot stand alone, we need to collaborate with the other healthcare provider. So yes, I positively say that we can do the collaboration to train all international pharmacists.
Thank you, Dr. Sahimi. Well, the other question you answered, it was related about that you, if you have facilities in your pharmacy, for your pharmacy graduates to take anticoagulation as a career choice. Well, you have said that yes. Well, we don't have any questions, any more questions. Let me see if here, no, we don't have in the chat neither. So I just want to thank all participants. It was a very interesting exposition about the very important role that pharmacists can take in anticoagulation. Sorry. Or it was another, just a reason that appeared now in the question and asked. Well, today is the World Thrombosis Day. And as I was saying, thank you everyone for participating in this very interesting webinar about the possibilities of pharmacies in anticoagulation therapy control. We ask you to check the other digital events that are going to happen. And thank you for your attention and your participation in this event. Thank you.